Well, hello, my friends. It's Shawn Petite, and welcome back to my YouTube channel. Look at this yummy goodness we're creating. Here's the supplies that we'll be using today and the stencils we'll be using today that are new to the shop. All right, so I'm working on a 12 by 12 MDF board, and I've got a bunch of papers out here. I've got a lot of scraps that I cut up, and then I thought that I might use some of the collage papers that I created over the last few days, but that didn't end up happening. And there were a lot of things that didn't happen or did happen on this project. It was a slow road, but I got there, and I decided to just take you along for the journey. There was a point during all of this that I thought I might be abandoning this project, but I kept going, and it ties right into the conversation that I share at the end. So I'm putting all of my papers down with my Liquitex fluid matte medium, and I have a specific color palette here that I'm showing you that I wanted to stick to. The colors were represented what I was feeling and the inspiration behind the piece, and so I was determined to stick to that color palette. And it was a challenge at some points, but in reality it wasn't bad at all. So I've got some Lucas acrylic paints out here, and all the supplies will be listed on the blog, and the link to the blog will be down below in the YouTube description box. So I've got my color shaper, and I end up using two different color shapers, and this is where my color shaper shined. I have been trying to find my place with it, and this is the place. Those thin, yummy layers of abstract and different. Oh. Every time I tried to use my fingers or a brush, I ended up going back to my color shaper. So it was the star. I'm just putting my colors down now, and I'm sticking with my color palette. I did the gesso and the beige and the yellow in the background, and now I'm bringing in those bold colors, and I positively love them. But this first part, and here's one of the new stencils. This is the vintage pattern stencil duo. And I wanted to bring some of that pattern kind of coming off of the color. And what you are seeing now will be completely different at the end. Here's another new stencil in the shop. It is called Abstract Layers 2. And so you can see here, I've switched to a different size color shaper, and I go to start using my fingers, and I know it. I'm like, that's not what I want. And I would go back to the color shaper, and it was perfect because I wanted to be able to edit. And when you're doing abstract in any form, it's about laying down layers and editing. You're constantly editing what you've just put down. And I worked this for, this was a, I did this start to finish, and it was about 3 hours that it took me to do this, because I could kind of see the vision. I knew what I wanted to kind of the color and the feeling and all of that. But, and I'm just going to go for it here and kind of speed it up a little bit. But, I loved the color palette. I just could not find my way in it. There were so many things that I loved about it and was trying to keep and not edit out. And I didn't follow my own rules. If you've taken any of my workshops or watched any of my videos, I always say, don't be afraid to let go of the background. And I was afraid to do that because there were so many things that I loved about it. Some of that dark, dark color, some of the stenciling. It was all so very good, but what it was doing was it was keeping me from moving forward to find that perfect happy spot, to find my way in the piece, because I didn't want to let go of some of those areas. So you're going to see me slowly start to let go, start covering up some of the yummy colors, some of the stenciling, some of the other areas, and I'm going to do this several times before I find the sweet spot. And so I constantly will go back and forth between my fingers and a brush and my color shaper. So this is another new stencil, the Abstract 3 or 4 stencil. And I positively love, so this color green was part of my color palette. And I love this color with all of the other colors. And the green against that kind of violet color and against the magenta, it just was so happy. It made me happy. And then this kind of olivey green, this is another one of the abstract stencils. And so these two patterns that I absolutely loved, the two greens, held me back for a long, long time because I loved them. I loved the color. I loved how they looked against all of the color, but I was afraid to kind of let go of them. So I'm like, I love this. Maybe I need to grungy it up a little bit. So I added a little bit of raw umber, and while I liked it, it was too much. So I had to come back in and edit that. And so I start pulling some of that back, and I wanted to kind of soften some of those edges. I didn't want them to be too harsh. So again, I'm editing, pulling back some of that real dark. And I happened to grab some deep violet. It's Golden's High Flow. And it was like the magic color. And especially over that raw umber, I put that deep violet over that raw umber, and it was like angels sang for me. It just was so beautiful. And then it was so sheer that it allowed the other things to show through. So it was like the perfect marriage of all the things. And this, again, so this corner up here that I'm working on that has a little bit of circle that's really, really dark in the upper left corner, I loved it. Positively loved that. So then I thought, okay, if I love that, then maybe I need to kind of recreate some more of that. So that was the process I took at that point. And was really trying, and I was loving the deep violet, loving it, as you can tell. And still trying to hang on to my two shapes, my two greens, and still loving that top left corner. And everything started getting busy again. And so I needed to start editing again. And we're gonna do this a couple of times. And I thought about really just kind of taking a lot of this out, but I think it's really important to see the process, because this process is important, because if I didn't do all of this, the wonderful layers and all of the things that are involved, part of the final piece, are so gorgeous. The texture from all of the layers, from the papers, from everything, so good. So I am bringing back in some of the color because I loved that yellow in the background and it got covered up. So I'm again adding, subtracting until you find your way. And so with my editing, I took out some of that yummy deep violet, and so I put it back in, of course, because I really loved it and I wanted the piece to kind of feel balanced. And so I was bringing it, you know, kind of around the piece, and you can see how deliberate I'm being, because I wanted to show part of what I was doing in real time, because I was being very deliberate about where I was going with it. And it'll all change, which is part of the process. And it's part of the journey too. It's part of the meditative place that we go to when we're creating. So loving that deep, deep violet, adding more to the piece, and still trying to protect the two things that I loved, which at this point are not working any longer. But I wasn't willing to let go of it yet. And that could be such an wonderful meaning in the conversation at the end. Yeah, part of the process. So I'm just gonna go for it with all of the violet and really layer that up. And so what I was trying to do was the two, at the beginning, it felt very divided, like one side and the other side, and then you had this white strip in the middle. Then I kind of got rid of that, and now I just put it all back. So I am adding a little bit of that quinacridone magenta back in because it kind of got hidden a little bit. And you can see how careful I'm being about these silly green spots. And so I'd worked it and I'm working it. I had worked it now for probably about an hour and a half. and I wasn't loving it. And I had kind of divided the piece again, and I had added all this color back in after I'd edited it back out. Sometimes that's how it goes, though. We have to get to that spot. So now I'm going to start taking it back out, softening it down, and I don't take it completely out yet. But sometimes you just kind of have to find your way. Okay, so I'm about ready to say, all right, I don't know what I'm doing. I need to stop this. Then I decided, ugh, the light bulb came on. And I'm like, stop it. Stop saving the let go of the things that you love to make the piece come together. So that's what I did. And then it was like, oh, everything. I added the green back in. I still love the green, but I did it differently. And once I did this, it was like everything clicked. I'm still working within my same color palette. I'm editing, I'm simplifying, I'm still keeping my yummy, wonderful, deep violet color and my magentas. But I've really kind of brought the focus into just a few areas instead of all over the place. And there'll be more editing still to come. Okay, so I purposely put that white in there to keep it from feeling divided. And then I went back and did the same thing again. I divided it. I'm like, oh my goodness, what is happening? So now I will come back in again and open that back up. And once I did this part right here, it felt that there were these pockets that I absolutely loved in the corners. And so I kind of worked with that. And as soon as I got some scribbles in, I knew I could feel it coming together. I could feel it feeling more like me. And then this green was the moment I knew that I had saved it. because and I needed different lines. I had the same up and down lines the entire time. And I needed some linear lines. And as soon as I did that, I needed some different line work instead of just these short brush strokes. And as soon as I did it, it felt like home. And that green kind of calmed everything down. It felt like it brought it together. So I'm going to just continue to define and refine. And the nice thing is that all of the layers underneath show up in so many wonderful ways. Even my first square and circle outline show up. And so I was like, I need something kind of top to bottom to kind of pull everything together, to bring the eye down. And I just drug my brush across just to kind of see how it felt, and I left it. So I brought my circle back in, or my oval back in umber. And I sprayed it with some water because I knew I wanted to soften it. I wanted it to be real soft and grungy. And so I'll soften these two, and I combined a little bit of plum and umber together in that diamond. And this is another one of the abstract stencils. And it was just perfect. A little bit of scratchy marks with my Stabilo all pencil, and I'm At this point, I'm like, oh, I can feel I'm taking it home. And so my Stabilo All pencil, and I'll just kind of activate some of that to get some of that really kind of watery, unpredictable lines showing up. And that black, it kind of neutralize and kind of bring everything together, keep the eye moving around the piece. Now, I have this Sumi paper that I recently got that I love, and I probably could have done without this, but it felt like the right thing at this point, because I knew I was putting my focal point down. So these are the abstract leaves, and I wasn't sure which one I wanted, and I knew I wanted to do them on white because I really wanted them to stand out and I could grungy them up. And I thought if I put that Sumi paper down behind it, it would stand out, but it was too light. But it still was awesome because you kind of see that rough edge. And so I found the right leaves that I wanted. And then I have my words that were the inspiration from the quote. And I'm putting all of that down. And then I'm just going to go to town grunging up my leaves. And I'm using my Stabilo All pencil first to just kind of make some lines and some squiggly marks and different things like that around my stenciled leaves. And I did these leaves really abstract. Of course, they're called abstract leaves because I wanted to be able to have them look a little bit different and abstract for this very purpose. And so I'm just going to use my Stabilo All pencil now and just kind of really bring in some dark lines, kind of carry it all the way up to the top and to the bottom, just real scratchy and then watery. And I'm going to go all the way around each of the leaves and everything with my Stabilo All pencil. And then I'm just using the same abstract stencil for some marks, some lights and some darks, which are neutralizing. And it brings that focal point together to that white and that black. This is some Liquitex acrylic ink in transparent raw umber. And I'm just laying that down kind of randomly. I didn't want to cover up everything, but I still wanted to bring some of that grungy brown in, kind of tone down some of that white and pull it all together. So all of the supplies will be listed on the blog, and the link to the blog will be down below in the YouTube description box. All the new stencils are in the shop and you can take a look at them there. They're so fun, so much fun. Adding just a little bit more of that acrylic ink around to kind of, again, balance the piece out. But at this point, I am in love with this. This was a journey and it was so good. The layers are just fantastic. I will use my charcoal pencil to kind of highlight some of my, some of the words that I've put down. And I hope you stick around for the conversation at the end because it's a good one. I was passionate about this week's inspiration because I needed to hear it myself in so many ways. And so I hope you'll stick around for that conversation. And if you enjoyed today's project, I hope you subscribe and like and share and all those wonderful things. I've got my fine line applicator out here and just kind of bringing in some more linear movement in my branches. Adding just a few more white marks here and there. And that's about it, my friends. I will shade the edges, add a few more marks here and there, and We're going to call it finally done. What a journey, but what a good one. All right, my friends, thank you so much, and I will see you next week. Well, hello, my friends, and happy Sunday to you. I am so proud of myself for keeping to my original palette, my colors. I really wanted to stick to it. And man, we took the long road, or I took the long road with this one, but I got here. And when I started this piece, I had an idea, but I didn't know where I was going yet. And this is often how any project, when I have a new idea or new color palette or new things like that, it kind of goes in that where there's just layers and layers. But the texture, all those layers are fantastic. Oh, all the layers of the paper, and then all the layers of paint, and all the different things that happened in the first layer still show through. Oh my goodness, I positively love this. Okie dokie. So the new workshop, Step by Step, is out and available to you. And the new spring stencils, I have been doing videos. By the time you see this video, I will have been doing several videos, just kind of showing them off, doing some different projects, collage papers and different things. And then of course, using them here as well. Super fun stencils. And I designed them to really kind of be abstract and fun, and lots of different background ones. This one's gonna be a favorite of mine. But to kind of work with some of the abstract feelings that I've been having, like the vines are real abstract. Yeah, so many. And then some vintage patterned ones, some little flowers. Oh, just so many good ones that I just love, love, love. Can't wait to just use them all. I think I've used them, almost all of them, in the last like 4 videos or so. So I hope you check those out, and then you can check out the stencils and the new workshop and all of that goodness for this week. So much fun. So many fun things to explore. Let's see what else. I think that's enough. I don't think there's anything else. All right, so I had a meaning. So I knew that I wanted to try my new stencils, and I wanted to do some abstract work. And I had a meaning. So if you have not read this book, I highly suggest it. It's just, and I didn't read it all in one setting. I kind of flipped back and forth through it, but each chapter is just phenomenal. And it's 12 lessons to save your life. And you can tell by the dog ears and the bookmarks and all the things in here that I go back to it often. But this week I started reading in one of the chapters that says, "No one rejects you but you. The prison of guilt and shame." And I know it's deep. I know that's deep. And I won't go into all of the things that she talks about, but I want to just read a couple of lines to you. And I have dealt with guilt and shame for a long time, and I think we all do in some sense, and have gone through therapy and lots of different things to kind of work my way through that. But it's still an ongoing thing. I think it will always be. Maybe the older I get, the less I care about things as much, but there's a couple of lines that just hit home to me this week, with some self-doubt and different things that I was having. And you know, it's kind of those old tapes that at unexpected times pop up within me and start to play again that I haven't heard in a long time. And it kind of stops me in my tracks. I'm like, wait a second. And I know the steps on how to deal with it. So I go through my steps but I was reading this chapter just to kind of get some goodness. But she writes, freedom lies in accepting our whole imperfect selves and giving up the need for perfection. Oh Lord, help me. I mean, my goodness, I can so relate and resonate with this. I know I'm not perfect. I'm not a perfect person, but sometimes I can be that perfectionistic person. Because of all the layers of life and rejection and all of the things that we all come up against in our lives, even if we've had a perfect upbringing, there's still those layers of things that affect us or words that were said to us that we can kind of hold on to. You can see all the underlining, but here's this one line again that says, no one rejects you but you. No one rejects you but you. I had to say that over and over again because I know, especially as an artist and being out there and showing myself in my work and all those kinds of things, sometimes rejection is part of the deal. And I can get a million compliments and one negative compliment, oh, it like gives me a gut punch. And I've forgotten all the great things, all the other wonderful things that people have said. And it's not just my art or anything like that. It's life and in relationships. You know, we can have great relationships, but there can be one word or two or a certain action that's done where we feel where I feel some rejection. But no one rejects me but me. It's like, I read that and it was like silent in my brain. I'm like, oh, yeah, good reminder. Because I know all of this. And yet I still have to back up a little bit and walk my way through some of my self-doubt and all those things. So she goes on to say, and it explains guilt and shame. And I'm not going to get into that, all of that. I hope you guys get a book if you don't already have it. But she says, we get to choose how we talk to ourselves. We get to choose. We get to choose how we talk to ourselves. And so in this process of having some sense of rejection or trust or those kinds of things, or, you know, negative comments about you or who you are or what you do or all those things, what do you do, or what can I do? And I have always learned, what I've always been taught to say, what can I learn from this, instead of taking it internally. The author, who I'm sorry, is Edith Edgar. She's a Holocaust survivor. She says, ask yourself, is there anything helpful here that can support my growth and creativity? So when somebody comes against you and gives you feedback or criticism or says something that maybe is hurtful to you at the moment, sometimes we need to hear some of those things. Sometimes we need those small moments. And I think there's a lot of ways to tell someone things without hurting them. But sometimes it just happens. And the part of that happens because of what we're already telling ourselves. So if I'm already doubting myself and someone comes to me and says, hey, you know what? I think this piece of art would look so much better if you had some more turquoise or a different color palette. I like this. I don't like the leaf, you know, whatever it might be. This is just an example of art, but it can happen in life. And if I'm already in that place of self-doubt and self-criticism, and I've got those negative tapes happening, and I'm talking badly to myself, and then someone says something like that, what does it do? It confirms my bad talk about my... I go, oh, see, I'm not a good artist. I don't know what I'm doing. But if I were to say, well, is there anything here that can support my growth or creativity? Or how I say it, what can I learn from what this person is saying? Is there something I can learn from this? And sometimes there isn't. Sometimes I can look at myself, my art, my relationship, my whatever arena we can apply this to, I can look at all of this and say, no, I love it just the way that it is. No, I'm doing the best that I can. No, I am whatever. I am working as hard as I can. No, I'm a good mother. No, I'm a good spouse. Whatever it is, if there's anything that we, and sometimes there are things that you can say, you know what, I need to be kinder, or I need to be this, or I need to work on this. But we don't let it define who we are. We don't let those negative things further add fuel to the fire of guilt or shame or criticism within ourselves. We get to choose how we talk to ourselves, and I know I struggle with, and often can stop myself in my tracks and say, no, I am doing a good job. Instead of saying, see, I'm not a good artist. So we get to choose how we talk to ourselves. And then she goes on to say, where is it? Pay attention to what you're paying attention to. That's what you reinforce. So what are you paying attention to? You're paying attention to the good things in your life, the good things, the things that you're good at, because that's what we reinforce. These thoughts will influence how you feel. How you feel is going to dictate how you act. You weren't born with shame. Your genuine self is already beautiful. You were born with love and joy and passion, and can rewrite your internal script and reclaim your innocence. You can become whole. We get to choose how we talk to ourselves. We get to choose how we talk to anybody. But most importantly, how we talk to ourselves, because how we're talking to ourselves is how we're going to talk to other people. And accepting who we are, our whole selves, knowing that we are beautiful and that you were born with love and joy and passion. And even if life has been hard and those things, maybe someone has tried to take those from you, we get to choose to focus on those things so that we can see those things, we can live those things, we can repeat those things. So these are my words here. Choose, accept who we are. We get to choose how we talk to ourselves. We get to accept our whole selves. We get to reclaim that innocence. We get to reclaim and focus on the good parts of us. Maybe some things were stolen from us throughout our childhood or whatever. We get to reclaim that. And then we get to be whole. And then I added free, because when we do those things, there's freedom. There's such freedom in being okay with who you are and stopping the negative talk. Choosing to talk to yourself with love and not feeling guilt or shame for who you are. And so that is this piece. That is, this was perfect, because this was a catastrophe. I mean, it wasn't a catastrophe, because look at it. Look at how amazing this is. And even if you don't think this is amazing, I do. I love it. I love the colors. I'm proud of myself for sticking to my color palette. And I was proud of myself for sticking with it, because at one point I'm like, maybe I just need to not do this and do something different, which could have been a good option. But I stuck with it, and I'm so glad that I did, because I positively love this. And then as I was kind of nearing the end, I thought, well, isn't this just perfect? Because this is the lesson. I got to choose how I talk to myself through this piece of art. And at first I was like, oh Lord. And that's kind of, I mean, it's not a perfect journey ever. When it comes to ourselves and our growth and our wholeness, it's a constant work in progress. And this piece was a perfect example of that, because I continued and I did my self-talk through it. I'm like, because at one point I'm like, maybe I should start over. And then I'm like, I can make this beautiful. I can make this into something. I can do this. I'm going to do it. And I'm so pleased that I stuck with it. So my loves, I say all that to say, I was so inspired by this chapter. Choose how you talk to yourself. Be good to yourself. Reclaim your joy and your peace and your innocence. Be whole and accept who you are. All the things, all the flaws, all the things that we have to, that we are. They're beautiful, just as you are. And then when something comes about that triggers us, or we get feedback or criticism or whatever, ask yourself the right question. What can I learn from this? Is there something in this thing, this information, or these words that someone is firing at me, is there something in there that I can learn or can help me grow? And if there's not, then let it go. Let it go. And you get to choose how you talk to yourself. So talk lovingly. Talk lovingly. We need it. We need it. All right, my loves. I hope your Sunday is peaceful and restful, and you are so amazing just as you are. And I hope that you always, always know that you are loved.